Okay, welcome everyone to the second day of this year's Berkeley Tanner Lecture events. I'm Jay Wallace, Vice Chair of the Berkeley Tanner Lectures Committee, and I'm delighted to have you all back here for our second lecture with our distinguished speaker, Professor Philippe Descola. I just want to second something that Philippe said yesterday, which was to offer a word of thanks to Jane Fink for her remarkable organization of these events and for making everything happen so smoothly. We're really deeply in your debt, Jane. Great, and without further ado, Philippe was introduced yesterday. Let me invite him to the podium for his second lecture, which will be on forms of assemblage.
Let me reiterate my thanks to the Tanner Committee and Professor Jay Wallace for inviting me to deliver the Tanner Lectures in Berkeley, and also my warmest thanks for the discussants who have come sometimes a very long way to be here and discuss my propositions with me. In my first lecture yesterday, I attempted to sketch the program of a political anthropology beyond the human, which would be faithful to the ways according to which the human components of extramodern cosmopolities conceptualize their own form of assemblage by contrast with the Eurocentric and anthropocentric manner of doing so, which consists in projecting the ontological template of naturalism onto very diverse sociocosmic realities. As I said yesterday, I will limit myself to considering those cosmopolities that belong to an animist regime. First, because they are the ones I know best, and second, because they differ perhaps the most from the forms of collectives to which the sociology of the moderns have accustomed us. Wherever the ontological regime of animism dominates in this discontinuous archipelago that includes the lowlands of South America, the high latitudes of North America and East Asia, and a string of populations of Southeast Asia and Melanesia, the same types of collectives are to be found, but populated by very different beings. For each form of being constitutes a collective of its own, a social species characterized by a particular morphology, type of behavior, and dispositions, a kind of grouping that combines the attributes of a natural species and that of a tribe. In the case of humans, each ethnic group, each tribe, each dialectal group is thus seen as a species whose means of acting on the world and the ways of occupying it are the result of an equipment which is distinctively its own. The tools, the weapons, the language, the ornaments, the dwelling, the techniques of subsistence, the forms of authority, the rules of marriage and descent, all the features that we consider ordinarily in the West as typically cultural, are seen in the animist regime as, so to speak, natural attributes, intrinsic to the particular species of humans that they characterize and serve to identify, in the same way that the shape of the beak, the color of the plumage, the type of nest, the diet, and the sound messages will make it possible to differentiate this or that species of bird. The animist world is thus composed of collectives of humans and collectives of non-humans, mostly animal species, plant species, and races of spirits, including the human dead, all of which are governed by institutions similar to those of the human collective, which serves as an interpretive template for the non-human collectives with which it interacts. From this point of view, members of all collectives are deemed to see themselves as human, regardless of their generic forms, and it is only in the eyes of other collectives that each of them appears with its proper characteristics. In other words, the identity of a collective is only visible under the gaze of others. Its particularities of form and behavior are only apprehended as signs of its singularity by those who belong to other tribe species. A good example of this interlocking of points of view, produces differentiated collectives is offered by a Matsigenga myth from the Peruvian Amazon. The myth relates a journey undertaken by some Matsigenga to discover the world, which leads them to visit peoples defined each time by their diet. Each new people seems in every way similar to the Matsigenga visitors. They speak the same language, they have the same type of dwelling, the same type of subsistence techniques, and the forest environment they occupy does not differ in any way from that of the Matsigenga. The people they visit first give them fish for dinner. And then the next day, offer to go fishing with them. But they actually catch poisonous snakes, which they call fish, and eat as such. Showing their disgust, the Matsigenga visitors are invited by their hosts to go and look for snake meat in a river, where they find a quantity of fish that they bring back to the village where they are staying. Each of the two groups, seeing the others bring back snakes, reproaches them for eating filthy food, and each decides to eat separately at nightfall. The hosts consuming their snakes which they see as fish, while the Matsigenga consumes their fish, which the householders see as snakes. The visits to other villages follow one another. The next village is populated by people who eat coral snakes that they call paca. The paca is a small mammal with a very delicate flesh. The same kind of misunderstanding occurs again. The Matsigenga go to find a paca in its burrow and bring it back for dinner, to the great disgust of their hosts who see only a large coral snake, while the Matsigenga reproach their hosts for eating coral snakes that they take for pacas. The next village is inhabited by people who trap and eat bats that they see as tangara birds. The next one is populated by people who hunt with bows, fireballs that they see as macaws. From there, the Matsigenga go to the home of vulture eaters who see these scavengers as penelopes. A penelope is a species of gallinaceous bird with very fine flesh also. And they then decide to return home. So the differences in perspectives between humans and non-humans that the Matsigenga story highlights are examples of that metaphysics of interspecies relations so common in the Amazon that Eduardo Viveros de Castro has called perspectivism. I recall the canonical definition that Viveros de Castro gave of it. I quote him, "Humans, under normal conditions, see humans as humans, animals as animals, and spirits, if they see them, as spirits. Animals, that is to say animal predators and spirits, see humans as animal preys, while animal in the guise of game see humans as spirit or as animal predators. Animals and spirits, on the other hand, see themselves as humans. They apprehend themselves as or become anthropomorphic when they are in their own villages or homes and live out their own usages and characteristics under the species of culture. Perspectivism is the expression of the idea that any being that occupies a point of reference and is thus placed in the position of a subject apprehends itself under the species of humanity. The bodily forms and usages of humans constituting pronominal attributes of the same type as ethnonymic self-designations. In practice, however, perspectivism is neither generalized to the entire animist archipelago nor exclusive to it. One finds striking examples in the populations of Mongolia and Central Asia, which seems to oscillate between an analogous and an animist regime, depending on where they live. Perspectivism is expressed primarily in myth, in accounts of shamanic experiences, and in judgments about the capacity of this or that class of beings, so that it must be seen as a kind of epistemic theory of interspecies knowledge, or codification of the positional character of certain ontologies, not as a practical code or a practical vademecum of interactions between human and non-human collectives. The register of animism is of the order of speculative philosophy, and it is in this direction that Viveros de Castro has developed perspectivism lately, not in that of everyday sociology, on which it has no normative hold. It expresses a logical possibility in a two-position game. If humans see themselves in human form and see non-humans in non-human form, then non-humans who see themselves in human form should see humans in non-human form. But in practice, such an epistemology of mutual knowledge between species would render interactions between humans and non-humans extremely difficult, since they are based on a permanent misunderstanding. Humans must either accept in their relations with animals and spirits that there is no coincidence of views, which can have very unfortunate consequences for them, or they must mentally correct the reversal of perspectives each time to realign them. This is why, in most actual interactions between human and non-human collectives, as opposed to the theory of their mutual knowledge, animist populations usually behave as if the non-humans saw them in their human form, not as predatory animals or spirits. Conversely, what the ethnography of the animist archipelago amply demonstrates is that the dominant patterns of relationship between human collectives are also those that characterize the relationships between human and non-human collectives. I have highlighted in my book, Beyond Nature and Culture, that these dominant patterns of relation within and between animist collectives correspond to the three formulas ensuring the potentially reversible movement of any value between two terms having the same ontological status. The first of these formulas, exchange, is characterized as a symmetrical relation in which any consenting transfer from one entity to another requires a counterpart in return. The other two formulas are asymmetrical. Either an entity A takes a value from an entity B, it can be its life, its body, or its interiority, without offering any counterpart, and I call predation this negative asymmetry, or on the contrary, an entity B offers a value to an entity A, and it can be itself, without expecting any compensation. And I call gift this positive asymmetry. If we focus on the obligations that arise from the form of these different types of transfer, rather than on the movement of the things transferred, then we obtain a body of normative prescriptions governing the relations between beings belonging to the various collectives, a veritable animist sociology. Let us recall briefly from Amazonian ethnographic examples the different forms that this animist sociology can take, governing both human and non-human collectives. A most remarkable illustration of the scheme of prediction is provided by the group of speakers of Heinz Chicham, which is the new name under which people formerly known as Jivaro are now called. They live in the Ecuadorian and Peruvian Amazon. Headhunting between the tribes of this linguistic group and the vendetta within each of them constituted the main mechanism for structuring individual destinies and bonds of solidarity, as well as the most visible expression of a central value, namely the obligation to acquire from others the individuals, substances, and principles of identity deemed necessary for the perpetuation of the self. It has been common in anthropology to interpret war and vendetta as an exchange of death regulated by so-called negative reciprocity. However, if we take seriously both what the speakers of Heinz Chicham do and the commentary they propose on their actions, and if we also admit that the necessary condition of exchange is obtaining a counterpart, then it is impossible to characterize war among and within this set of tribes as an exchange of death. Indeed, if headhunting and vendetta usually generate reprisals, they're obviously not sought as a counterpart to which one is entitled as a result of the death inflicted on others. And people instead take all measures to escape their consequences. So the violent and reciprocal appropriation of others within the set of Heinz Chicham speakers is thus the product of a negation of peaceful exchange, not the deliberately sought after result of an exchange of human lives through a bellicose interaction. The relationship of the speakers of Heinz Chicham with non-human collectives are also structured by the pattern of predation. Many plants and animals, however, are considered to share certain ontological attributes with humans, with whom they are linked by relationship of consanguinity and affinity. In spite of this, non-humans are not integrated into a network of exchange with humans, and no counterpart is given to them when their lives are taken in subsistence activities. As with humans in their relations with other humans, non-humans even tend to seek revenge for the predation to which they are subjected, as illustrated by the case of manioc. This plant, which constitutes the staple food, is reputed to suck the blood of the women who cultivate it and that of their young children through their leaves. So the capture of real or virtual people among close or distant enemies, the appropriation of game without compensation, and the daily guerrilla warfare with cannibal manioc thus express in different domains an identical refusal of exchange in relations with others human or non-human. I hasten to add that such an attitude is not peculiar to the speakers of Einstigem. Many other examples of generalized predation can be found in the animist archipelago, in Amazonia, and in Southeast Asia also. Cases where exchange is the dominant pattern are also very common in the Amazon. For example, among the Tucano and Carib-speaking populations of the northwestern part of the region, who form an integrated multi-ethnic group. The imperative obligation of exchange between human collectives is manifested, first of all, in a spectacular way by the linguistic exogamy that commands each local group to obtain its wives from groups that speak a language other than its own. Other factors contribute to the interweaving of the peoples of the Amazonian Northwest in an inclusive regional organization, notably the regional division of the production of artifacts, which confer on each tribe a reputation of excellency and therefore exclusivity in the making of a type of object necessary to the daily life of all. This specialization, which is an artificial specialization, contributes to a generalized circulation of artifact that accentuates the feeling of consensual dependence of everyone on everyone. Finally, the bonds of dependence are reinforced by the systematic practice of long-term visits and regular drinking parties. So in spite of the diversity of languages, each longhouse, each descent group, each Tucano linguistic group is thus conscious of owing its material and ideal durability to regulated exchanges with the other parts of the whole. In the relationship with the animal world, it is also a logic of parity in compensation that governs interactions, since any animal killed in the hunt must be compensated by a counterpart provided by humans to the master spirits of the game, which may even sometimes take the form of the soul of a deceased human who will be transformed into an animal destined to be hunted. A final pattern of relations characteristic of the animist collectives is that of gift or sharing, in which the transfer of a value does not call for a counter-transfer. In the Amazon, this pattern of relationship is well illustrated by the Arawak-speaking populations of the foothills of the central Andes of Peru, a multi-ethnic group to which the Matsigenga belong, whose perspectivist myths I mentioned a moment ago. Among this group, generosity, solidarity, and the predominance of the common good over the interests of the parties have been elevated to the rank of a supreme canon of behavior. The game animals and their masters are essentially a race of spirits called our people or our conspecifics, who are deemed to be well disposed towards humans. Most hunted birds are themselves embodiments of spirits, and their killing is a mere simulacrum. After the hunter has asked for its clothing, the bird offers its fleshy envelope to the arrow out of compassion for the hungry hunter, while preserving its immaterial interiority, which is reincarnated into an identical body or regains its invisible human appearance. He therefore incurs no damage, and this act of benevolence does not call for any compensation. This kindness is explained by the fact that the spirits, their animal transformations, and the species they command are ontologically identical to humans. the Arawak people regard them as very close relatives, and the gift of their remains is a simple token of the duty of generosity that must prevail between people of the same kin. The altruism and prodigality shown by the animal spirits in the donation of their remains is in fact an echo of in the relations between humans, human and non-human collectives, of the internal relations of human collectives on the scale of the sub-Andean Arawak linguistic set, relations characterized by an ethos in which trust, generosity, and the horror of constraint are privileged. These peoples have indeed pushed very far the will to ward off dissension and otherness or alterity within themselves by reducing to a minimum these gaps between individuals, which are indispensable for a relation of reciprocity or predation to be established. They are particularly known for the strong censorship they exercise against internal violence, a source of lasting resentment, and a factor in the disintegration of the social bond. The ideal of giving and sharing as the dominant pattern of relations between collectives has been described in many other regions of the animist archipelago. For example, in the Algonquian tribes of northern North America, further north among the Inuit, or again far away among the Chewang of Malaysia and the Buid of the Philippines. The terms I use to describe the characteristic relations of animist sociology, predation, exchange, and gift, are obviously anthropological abstractions that are not formulated as such by the human collectives that implement them. These three major regimes of relations simply synthesize each of the forms of obligations that are imposed or not on the human and non-human terms of the relation. The obligation to give back in exchange, or on the contrary, the right to take without giving back, a right that is conceded to you in the gift, or that one claims for oneself in predation. But in the vocabulary of the local institutions of animism, these forms of relationships are formulated in the words of relationship between humans. The obligations of exchange are expressed in the vocabulary of relationships between affines. The gift is expressed in the vocabulary of obligations between close relatives, for example, the sharing of food, while the predatory relationship to game is expressed in the terminology proper to war or sexuality. However, the widespread use throughout the animist archipelago of a vocabulary denoting relations between humans to also designate relations between collectives of human persons and collective of non-human persons does not imply that the latter should be reduced to a metaphorical projection of the former. This is an important point. It is indeed the case that relations between humans are, in general, better specified than relations between non-humans, that the categories of humans are less numerous than the categories of non-humans, and that the behavior to be followed between humans are better prescribed and codified than the others. Moreover, and this is particularly the case in the animist archipelago, the normativity of prescribed attitudes, for example, between types of parents, is reinforced by their repetition. It is by conforming to relationships of familiarity or avoidance of respect of banter with this or that parent that the legitimacy and normality of their prospective character will emerge. But it is also because relations between humans allow for wider variations than observable interactions between non-humans, notably because their differences in instituted expressions become more apparent when one's own are compared with the critical eye to the forms they take in neighboring societies. It is enough to observe that the behavior of husbands toward their wives or the way parents treat their children is very different in the tribe next door than one visits from time to time, and that therefore the relationship between humans that it qualifies appears as a discrete relationship that can take several expressions. Relationships between spouses or relationships between parents and children are not just categories isolated by anthropologists. They provide all those who experience them with the material for reflexive comments and evaluative judgments that give these relationships sufficient consistency to be used for purposes other than the qualification of the relationships they originally characterize. So relations between humans appear as abstract schemes that are easily memorized and easier to mobilize for a wider use than the relations between non-humans detectable in an ecosystem. This is why the various expressions in human institutions of what I've qualified as predation, exchange, or gift can function in animist ontologies as cognitive frameworks for conceiving and qualifying not only the relations of humans to all beings to whom they impute an interiority analogous to their own, but also the relations between these beings themselves. It is therefore in no way a metaphorical usage. It's rather the use of a label borrowed from the field of relations between humans to designate a more encompassing relation. But animist cosmopolities are not only composed of beings organized in monospecific collectives and of the various relations woven between them. They also need a material support so that the elements that compose them, human and non-human, can deploy their existence. They must therefore organize themselves in order to share territories and the resources they contain. Now, a fairly common characteristic of the territoriality of monospecific collectives is the difference in the form it takes depending on whether one is dealing with human or with non-human collectives. With the exception of special cases such as the Maku hunter-gatherers and Tucano horticulturists of the northwestern Amazonia, whose use areas are intermingled, human tribe species generally occupy territories that they do not share with other human tribe species. While non-human tribe species most often use the same spaces as human tribe species and other non-human tribe species. In other words, the territories of humans, which in the animist world generally exploit the same resources on a regional scale and thus relate to the same type of non-humans, are largely exclusive and organized in a concentric pattern with a decreasing gradient of control relative to habitat sites. Whereas the territories of non-humans, especially those of animals, are structured in a complementary manner on the model of the ecological niche where different tribe species cohabit either to exploit different resources in the same space or to exploit the same resources at different times, or to share the resource under the regime of commensality when it is abundant. As a result, the relationship to the land of human tribe species may be quite distinct from that of non-human tribe species. I will examine one modality in Melanesia, that instantiated by the Kasua of the Mount Bozavi region in the heart of the islands of Papua New Guinea, to whom Florence Brunois devoted a remarkable monograph a few years ago. This is a very original work, since the author treats in a completely symmetrical way as so many components of the same status cohabiting in the forest cosmos, the Kaswa clan and the spirit races, the animals and the plants, the techniques and the narratives about them. The focus of her study is the dense network of links of interdependency between humans and non-humans in this biogeographic region with the highest biodiversity in New Guinea, a study that has the rare merit of not approaching humans and non-humans as if they were entities a priori confined to separate spheres, but taking them as elements within a single sociocosmic space. Brunois thus uses the same descriptive and analytical grid to assess the properties and relational forms of the various occupants of the Kaswa cosmos, whether they are humans, spirits, or animals. The richness of her ethnographic description makes synthesis difficult, so I will limit myself to giving a brief overview of the human and non-human collectives as seen from their relationship to the territory. The ecological zone currently occupied by the Kaswa, a population of just under 600 people, is a tropical rainforest extending over 2,000 square kilometers, a habitat that offers a great diversity of biomes and that the Kaswa do not share with any other human population. They display unquestionable animist characteristics. Thus, animals are seen as possessing an interiority of the same nature as humans, each species being distinguished from the others by its own physical and behavioral characteristics, dispositions, and cultural traits, if you wish. In addition, and I will come back to this later, the spirits who perceive themselves as humans in the invisible world perceive the spirit doubles of humans as game animals, which is a classic case, of course, of animist perspectivism, very common in this region of New Guinea. The most characteristic aspect of the collectives making up the Kaswa cosmos is the fact that they are not only highly territorialized, but also, and above all, defined primarily by the habitat they occupy. Let us begin with the animal collectives. The Kaswa distinguish 8 major supra-generic categories whose name can be substituted for that of the identified species. The one that interests us here, Abele, includes 51 species of mammals and the 2 species of cassowaries. In fact, Abele is both a supra-generic taxon and a functional category, since the term primarily refers to game animals. Within this category, animals are classified by their ecological niche. The mountain, the places where they nest, that is tree cavities, burrows or nests, and the base of trees. Similarly, the birds, anima, are distributed according to the level they frequent, from the ground-dwelling species to the birds of the sky. And because of the altitudinal layering of the Kaswa cosmos, it is not unexpected that the 400 or so animal species that occupy it are distributed in a mosaic of ecological niches, each of which has a territory that is recognized as a distinctive living space. In the same way that there is no supra-generic term for animals in Kaswa, which does not allow, at least on the semantic level, to isolate them within the forest cosmos as a macro category of beings independent of the territory they occupy, though there is no supra-generic term that would distinguish humans as an exclusive group, the closest term, ole et tolu, can be translated as those below or the lineages below, and it is logically opposed to those above, wabele et tolu, namely the spirits, both sets being defined spatially rather than ontologically. Let us see how the human collective is defined. The Kaswa are divided in 13 named exogamous patrilineal clans, which are above all highly territorialized. Each clan is singularized by the fact that its members share the same blood, a consubstantiality that is the basis for the prescription of exogamous marriages, but which must also, in order to be truly visible, be expressed in a special language. Consanguinity can only be thought of territorially. Since the last migrations stabilized several generations ago in the current clan territories, which are generally clearly delimited by rivers, these have hardly changed. They are varying size and located at different altitudes, so that each of them constitutes a sort of singular ecological niche, providing the clan that occupies it with a set of animal and plant resources that is specific to it. This association between a clan and its territory, conceived as an ecological niche, is sanctioned by a series of prohibitions. This transpecific territorialization also affects the territories of spirits, those above. The latter are usually invisible and are mainly distinguished from humans, those below, in that their place of residence is in the forest canopy. They are subdivided into three tribe species, the Gulu Hon, doubles of the human dead, the Sosu, and the Isanese, each composed of individuals of both sexes and of different generations who perceive themselves as humans. What differentiates each of these tribe species of spirits is not appearance, but the social, alimentary, and especially territorial behavior of each of them. The Sosu spirits are warriors and cannibals, and they are confined to the upper slopes of the Mount Bozavi, while the Isanese are composed of 100 or so individuals, each identified by a name, and they are distributed throughout the territory and lead a social and ritual life quite similar to that of the Kaswa. As for the Guluhon spirits, the doubles of the dead, they form a singular tribe species since its members are not born as such but become so. These transformed humans live in a specific place near the Ululu waterfall in a large house. Now, all these tribe species of spirits that remain invisible in normal times have the capacity to intervene in the visible world, primarily by occasionally borrowing the envelope of any animal. but which will be chosen from the ecological niche that each spirit community occupies. Thus, the social spirits manifest themselves in the form of the characteristic animals of their habitat, that is, the high-altitude ecosystem of Mount Bozavi, while the Isanese spirits are divided into territorialized collectives corresponding to each of the clan territories of the Kaswa, and they therefore take the form of the characteristic animals of the biomes corresponding to each of these territories. Within each territory of Isanese spirits, they occupy precisely located habitat sites, most often trees, hills, caves, and waterfalls. And in these sites, the Isanese manifest themselves through concrete signs, for instance, prints of the pigs that they have tamed that stop at the base of the sagu tree where they live, or domestic noises such as a door being closed or firewood being cut with an axe. The Kaswa take great care not to disrupt the spirits, for example, not to disturb the sites where the Isanese live or to speak among themselves the special language of the Sosu when they go into their territory. Otherwise, the spirits desert the area or become furious, scaring away games and attacking humans. So the rules of cohabitation in the Bozavi forest cosmos are very strict. The sharing of the same ecological niche forming a territory for human clan, for groups of spirits, and for animal and plant species requires the maintenance of equitable exchange relationships between all these communities. Thus, in each Kaswa clan territory, there's a special overlap of the milieus of many tribe species, which must therefore find accommodations between each other. The coexistence in an animist regime of different types of territories, according to the human and non-human collectives that occupy them, raises complex questions, notably for the establishment of legal guarantees protecting these territories within the frame of nation states. How to reconcile the interests of humans who in most cases claim exclusive use of the milieu they occupy vis-a-vis other humans, how to reconcile these interests with the interests of various categories of non-humans. Among them, on the one hand, plants and animals that are deemed to behave like humans and that share their territories with humans in the form of complementary ecological niche, and on the other hand, other types of non-humans, generally more or less vindictive spirits, whose territories are a little, completely, or not at all coincident with those of humans, who are nevertheless dependent in many ways on the actions of these generally invisible mediators with whom one must therefore not lose contact. Cosmopolitics becomes here a diplomatic exercise between tribe species. In an ordinary situation, that is to say, without external pressure on the territories of humans and non-humans alike, the human tribe species generally manages in these imbroglio situations with the ordinary means of animist collectives from the direct or indirect control of human demography to the prudential rules in hunting and fishing and to ritual mediations with the spirits protecting the plants and the animals. But the situation is no longer ordinary, and animist collectives are now exposed in the front line of the great movement of territorial plundering that is devouring their milieu. Forced to protect their territories against extractive multinationals or agricultural colonization, they must adapt the territorial layering and the modalities of cohabitation between humans and non-humans that I have just described to a logic of exclusive and spatially delimited appropriation characteristic of the modern ontology. In the Amazon, for example, and in contrast to the two-dimensional cartographic scheme of territoriality, the indigenous conception is based on an organicist scheme in which the territory is a large living body that feeds, reproduces, and weaves links with other bodies. It is not indifferent in that, in the sense that the collective house in some parts of Amazonia is often described as a body that maintains relationships with other body houses. The territory is the home where this organism deploys its appetite by using other organisms that it consumes or with which it composes. It thus takes the form of a network of relationships with decreasing density rather than a polygon bounded by fixed borders. This implies that the territory cannot be reduced to a vast enclosure seen from the sky, delimited according to the point of view of Sirius and cut into layers of information specifying the characteristics of the area of which it is composed, but that it must be apprehended from within at the level of the synecological exchanges and according to the point of view of one of its components which interacts with the others without imposing its totalizing perspective on them. The problem with this conception is that it does not lend itself easily to the identification and demarcation processes by which native reservations and protected areas are enshrined in the law of nation states. Where does the milieu necessary for the existence of this body territory end? What exactly does it contain? And at what point will the disappearance of some of its components make its survival impossible? These are crucial questions that all those who have had to intervene in the legal definition of native territories have had to confront. First and foremost, of course, the indigenous people themselves, and which in the present state of the modern concept of appropriation can only lead to compromises. I will give a brief example in conclusion. In the Ecuadorian Amazon lives a Quechuafon population known under the generic name of Sacharuna, people of the forest in Quechua. They enjoy village life and organize themselves into communities named after the main settlement site, often grouped around a chapel that is occasionally visited by a Dominican priest. There are no significant cultural, social, or linguistic differences between these Quechuafon village communities scattered along the rivers of Ecuador's central lowlands, but each tends to conceive of itself as an autonomous collective with its own identity. One of these communities, located on the middle course of the Bobonasa River, is called Sarayaku, after the large village that forms its main habitat. Sarayaku has gained some international notoriety due to its activism in defending its land rights and due also to the militant role of a French NGO that supports it. A delegation of Sarayaku was present at the COP21 taking place near Paris in 2015 and presented there a very interesting document entitled Causa Xacha, the Living Forest, proposal of the original peoples in the face of climate change. The document calls for the recognition of the territory that this Amerindian collective shares with the lost, with a host of non-humans, and the creation of an entirely new protected area category that would bear the generic name of Kausaksacha, living forest, in Quechua. The definition given to this term is not very different from the one I propose for animism. I quote them. Kausaksacha means that the forest is entirely composed of living beings and the communicative relationships that these beings maintain. All these beings, from the smallest plant to the protective spirits of the forest, are persons, runa in Quechua, who live in community and develop their existence in a manner analogous to that of humans. This is why, it's still the quotation, the objective is not only to preserve the territories of the First Nations, but also the material and spiritual relationship that these peoples weave with the other beings that inhabit the living forest. The important thing here, as can be seen, is the definition of territory as a form of singular relationship between humans and non-humans that unfolds in a milieu, not as a delimited space containing resources to be protected or exploited. However, at the same time that the leaders of Sarayaku have taken the decision to define the milieu which shelters their collective as an open space of relations between humans and non-humans, they have also taken the initiative of delimiting this milieu in the form of a classic territory by planting trees with contrasting flowers at its edge, which will thus form a visible boundary seen from the sky. The idea is certainly quite original and biophilic at first sight, but we see that it ends up producing a Westphalian mini territory, that is, a large quadrilateral of exclusive use and with intangible limits, recognizable only when seen from above, which of course is never the case for the inhabitants of this milieu, and extracted from the milieu it forms and the relationships that constitute it, in perfect contradiction with the definition of the Kausaksacha as a living forest. This Amazonian example shows how, for the purposes of legal recognition, two conceptions of territory come into conflict. A non-real conception, in which territory is seen and practiced as a form of singular relationship between humans and non-humans, unfolding in a milieu assimilated to a kind of mega-organism, and a Westphalian conception imposed by nation states in which territory is seen as a strictly bounded space of exclusive use containing resources to be exploited or protected solely for the benefit of humans. The examination of these few cases of animist cosmopolities, and without, of course, prejudging what examples of analogous and totemic cosmopolities could teach us, shows with clarity that there are as many cosmopolities as there are types of cosmos, and that a universal political regime based on the transposition of modern state institutions is a fiction that does violence to the way extra-modern human collectives conceive themselves. What form do animist cosmopolities take? Since almost all beings are persons, each one free and independent within the collective in which its existence takes place, it is not human individuals who constitute political subjects, nor even the autonomous assemblages within which beings of each species associate with their conspecifics in order to exist sovereignly. No, the real political subjects are the relations between the collectives, relations of seduction, exchange of services, predation or taming, variable according to the circumstances and to the communities, but which all have the characteristic of treating the alter ego as a person of equal status. A person who is killed or adopted, eaten or fed, helped to reproduce or treated like a child, depending on whether it is a friend or an enemy, a hunted animal, or the young of the game that is taken in, a cultivated plant or a wild plant, an evil spirit or a protective spirit. It is in these very diverse relations from person to person, between humans as well as with non-humans, that what Jacques Rancière calls relations of worlds crystallize. It is these relations that, according to him, form the texture of politics, much more than the relations of power. For as he writes, I quote him, a political subject is not a group that becomes aware of itself, gives itself a voice, imposes its weight in society. It is an operator that joins and disjoins the regions, the identities, the functions, the capacities existing in the configuration of a given experience. In this sense, any operator, human or not, is able to become a political agent if it manages to assemble beings that did not have intrinsic connections initially, notably because they belong in appearance to different ontological regimes. The Amazonian hunter who addresses a mental incantation to the soul of the woolly monkey he pursues is a political agent because he connects by this means two communities of persons who live in different physical worlds. As for the woolly monkey, he also becomes a political agent, and for the same reason, when he previously visited the same hunter in a dream to give him a rendezvous in the forest. Everywhere on our planet, these relations of worlds appear before our naturalist eyes without us always knowing how to decipher them as political expressions. For example, and in a register far removed from animism, when an Andean volcano threatened by a mining company is defended by native communities not as a resource to be protected, but rather as a full member of the mixed collective of which humans form a part, along with the mountains, the herds, the lakes, and the potato fields. Or when the Maori obtain recognition of the legal personality of the Whanganui River from the New Zealand Parliament, not so much as a means of preserving their ancestral use rights over it, but because, again, it belongs to a larger collective of which humans are only one component. Instead of seeing in the claims of the natives of Sarayaku, of the region of Cusco, or of the banks of the Whanganui River, manifestations of folkloric or childish superstitions, a condescending position that is equally shared by the laissez-faire liberalism as by the Promethean left, it is more judicious to focus on what it offers us, a formidable stimulation to think anew the kind of political action and way and ways of living together in a world where nature and society are no longer irremediably divorced. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Philippe, for that extremely stimulating lecture. Let's take a 7.5 minute break and reconvene here at 5:25 for comments. Okay, welcome back, everyone. Somehow, despite my attempts to impose Prussian order on these proceedings, 10 minutes have elapsed and not 7.5. But yeah, I need a gong. Anyway, welcome back. We have two commentators on today's lecture. Our first commentator is Timothy McCain, who's professor of history at Montana State University. Professor McCain is a wide-ranging scholar whose penetrating and influential contributions have grappled with important issues in environmental history and the history of technology. His first book, Mass Destruction, from 2009, is a study of giant open-pit copper mines in the American West, which contributed centrally to the electrification of the United States while wreaking havoc on the natural environment. The book was widely reviewed and won the 2010 award for Book of the Year from the American Society for Environmental History. Professor McCain's most recent book is The Matter of History, How Things Create the Past, published in 2017 by Cambridge University Press. This work develops a new approach to understanding the relation between the biological and cultural lives of humans and the material conditions in which they operate. The central idea is that material objects and processes shape and determine human life and culture as much as they are shaped by it. Professor McCain has drawn on this new materialist humanism framework in subsequent reflections on topics such as the pandemic and the idea that we're now living in a new environmental era, the Anthropocene. Professor McCain suggests provocatively that the current moment might better be thought of as the carbocene, quote, an age of powerful carbon-based fuels that have helped to create ways of thinking and acting that humans now find exceedingly difficult to escape. His interrogations of the relations between humans and the material objects and biological organisms with which they share the world make him a natural commentator on Philippe Descola's lectures, and we're eager to hear what he has to say about them. So please join me in welcoming Tim McCain.
All right, well, thank you, Jay, very much for that nice introduction. And I want to thank Jane as well and my co-commenters at home and David for their contributions. I think we've had an interesting conversation and we'll continue to. So it is really a genuine honor to be here with you this evening. Especially since, as you just heard, I'm neither an anthropologist nor a philosopher, but rather a historian, and a particularly peculiar type of historian at that, an environmental historian. But then I suppose that just goes to confirm the wide influence and importance of Professor Descola's work. Certainly his book, Beyond Nature and Culture, has had a big impact on my thinking. And it is the kind of book I frequently recommend to colleagues and students with the words, you've got to read. So I approach my comments tonight and for tomorrow from the perspective of a humanist and a historian with a longstanding interest in questions of nature and environment, animals and materialities, culture and politics. Professor Descola's provocative papers inspired many thoughts, but I ultimately managed to distill these down to two basic themes, which I hope to build usefully on some of his ideas more than perhaps offer a critique. The second of these, which I'll discuss tomorrow, regards what I'm calling a collective humanism. But for today, I want to explore a related though narrower idea, the topic of animism, ethology, and evolution. Now here, if you'll indulge me for just a few minutes, I thought a brief personal story might be helpful. Some years back, when I was much younger, I was walking through a sharp-sloped, densely wooded drainage in the Bridger Mountains of southwestern Montana. I'd been hunting grouse all afternoon, but the birds had elected not to show themselves that day. Now it was early evening, and I was heading back down the canyon. In late September, Night falls fast in the woods, and the shadows were already growing deep in the brushy undergrowth. I grew up in Montana. My father began bringing me along on hunting trips when I was about 10. He never said much about hunting. I mostly learned by watching, the need to walk slowly, soundlessly, the need to watch, to listen. That evening, as the darkness descended, I carried a Remington semi-automatic shotgun, a gun my father had given me when I turned 16, and which his own father had given to him. The Remington was loaded with 4 shells, each filled with small lead shot designed to take down a flying grouse without destroying the meat. Now, a few seconds later, this became a matter of some importance when I heard the sound of something a lot bigger than a grouse crashing through the undergrowth. I looked up to the slope on my left, and there was what, at least in that moment, seemed to me to be a very large bear, not more than 20 feet away. Without thinking, I began to raise the barrel of the shotgun. If the bear chose to attack, I supposed that I might have a few seconds to fire once, maybe twice, provided the old gun didn't jam, which it often did. Regardless, I doubted that a small birdshot would do much more than annoy any bear that was really bent on punishing me. For a long moment, that bear and I stared at each other. It was the first and the last time that I've ever looked into the eyes of a bear who was not safely caged in a zoo. I thought of that moment during our discussions yesterday and earlier when I was reading Professor Descola's most admirable papers. I wondered if that encounter that was both deeply visceral and emotional, but also strangely intellectual and scientific, might help us to imagine new ways of escaping modernist naturalism. One that would begin to build bridges to animist collectives, at least in part by shifting our attention from instrumentalist ecological questions to the more affective, emergent, and ontological questions of ethology and evolution. Not that I am in the least opposed to ecological thinking. Yet I wouldn't be the first to point out that at least some environmentalists have been a bit too quick to see in animism a sort of proto-ecological way of thinking, or a confirmation of James Lovelock's well-known Gaia thesis that the Earth is literally an organism. Indeed, at the very least, the animist cosmology does seem to harmonize with the environmentalist's exhortation to respect the non-human world, both for its own sake and because these non-human actors and systems are vital to our survival. What some identify with the somewhat instrumentalist term, ecosystem services. I don't doubt that these efforts are well-meaning. However, as Professor Descola's examples today demonstrate, the animist worldview is both far more profound and profoundly different than such facile ecologically rooted parallels might suggest. While a concept like ecosystem services, with its human subjects literally placed stage center, as you can see here, might well seem entirely nonsensical to them. In my own work in the Northern Rockies, I found that similarly quasi-animistic ecological views of charismatic wildlife run into oddly similar problems. For example, I've not infrequently encountered environmentalists who compare their appreciation of the critical role of the gray wolf and the restoration of ecological balance in Yellowstone National Park with animist ideas. Yet I suspect that few of these admirers of the wolf understand or embrace the deeper animistic belief that these animals possess a possible interiority similar to our own. Much less consider wolves to be literal relatives akin to uncles or aunts. Likewise, even as the tourist paparazzi jostled to glimpse Grand Teton's famous bear, 399, who is often celebrated in very human terms as an excellent mother and wise teacher of her cubs, I wonder how many would go beyond this affectionate anthropomorphism to embrace Grizzly 399 or any other bear as ontologically equivalent to themselves. Now, we might just dismiss this as an unfortunate but mostly harmless misunderstanding were it not that these shallow animistic ideas about so-called wild nature and the closely related and highly profitable business of wilderness tourism continue to reflect and reinforce the very naturalistic dichotomies that Professor Descola argues we must escape. Indeed, the potential threat of big predators like grizzlies is often used to reinforce and commodify this persistent idea of wild nature, red in tooth and claw. Yellowstone in this framing is worth paying a great deal of money to visit, because it is one of the few remaining places on the planet where there is a small but not insignificant chance that a visitor might be attacked and even eaten by a top predator. However, I would submit to you this is not an engagement with another animal so much as a plein air version of a horror ride, something you might find at Disneyland or Universal Studios. Ironically, while now considered to be ecologically and ethically backwards, earlier park policies once celebrated a more intimate human-bear interaction that may have offered more opportunities to transcend the naturalistic worldview. Although it's worth bearing in mind that bears who cross some ill-defined boundary to become a threat to tourists were often killed. Despite such misunderstandings, as Professor Descola points out, modernists and animists have occasionally succeeded in developing some productive alliances. As he was just saying, when the Maori famously secured recognition of the legal personhood of the Whanganui River from the government of New Zealand in 2017, he tells us their goal was less to preserve their ancestral rights to use the river than it was to secure official recognition of the river's indispensable ontological role in generating the human non-human collective that is the Maori. Now, I don't know how many non-Maori New Zealanders who supported that legislation fully understood or embraced this crucial ontological dynamic. Regardless, many likely welcomed the designation simply because it also aligned with their own more modernist goals of preserving the river for ecological, recreational, cultural, or other ecosystem services. Such uneasy alliances are surely not a bad thing if they can help us to save threatened organisms and ecosystems. Professor Descola's excellent point about the impossibility of such borders from the perspective of the animus notwithstanding. I would like to hope that most New Zealanders were sincere in their support for the Maori and their animist views, even if they did not fully understand or embrace these. Regardless, it seems clear, at least to me, that Professor Descola is asking for more than a sympathetic tolerance for and accommodation of animism. Rather, he is asking us to turn to animism, here I quote, as a formidable stimulation to think anew the kinds of political actions and ways of living in a world where nature and society are no longer irremediably divorced. So with the minutes I have left, I wanted to strike a surprising note of optimism and suggest that perhaps the divorced parties are already beginning to reconcile, but in a surprising way. Indeed, it seems to me that we are today witnessing a matter of new scientific thinking that offers a powerful challenge to modernist anthropocentrism and arrogance by revealing the extraordinary intelligence, creativity, and culture of non-human animals. Consider, for example, the long-standing modernist conceit that humans alone use language. Yet it's been decades since the Western lowland gorilla Coco showed that she could indeed understand spoken English and communicate with sign language. We also long assumed that a defining trait of Homo sapiens was their ability to make and use tools. Yet in 2002, The New Caledonian crow Betty was famously caught on tape, bending a wire into a hook to snare an otherwise unreachable treat. Even the lowly white lab rat now appears capable of empathy and altruism, as it will delay its own opportunity for a tasty chocolate treat to first rescue a fellow rat from an unpleasant swim. Now, to be sure, none of this work is without its critics. Nonetheless, in concert with countless other examples that I could tell you about, surely these new insights raise an important realization. If many traits once considered uniquely human now appear to be fairly common in other animals, albeit in attenuated forms, then these traits clearly must be evolutionarily advantageous. Further, if this is true, then perhaps it is not the science of ecology and ecosystem services that provide the most promising potential for dialogue with animist thinkers, but rather the science of ethology and evolution. Put differently, I wondered what Professor Descolas would think about the idea that maybe the ontology of evolution offers a useful bridge to the ontology of animism. Now, quickly, I must stress, of course, it's not my intent to suggest that these new scientific insights into non-human animals should in any sense supersede the intimate place-based knowledge of the extra-modern peoples Professor Descolas has told us about. Rather, I would hope this potential bridge between animism and evolution, and perhaps also between ethnology and ethology, could offer a useful means of productive engagement between these diverse contemporary collectives. And so, to return to that bear and me, as we stood there together in the fast fading light, my gun half raised, staring into each other's eyes across the chasm that seemingly separates humans and animals, culture and nature, I'd like to tell you that I saw some flicker of mutual understanding in that bear's dark eyes, some shared ontological affinity. But I did not. But really, how could I have seen such a thing? Unlike an animist hunter of the Amazon jungles, I only occasionally visited the forest. I'd spent 99% of my life in a city, living in a warm house where the darkness disappears with a flick of a switch. But the thing is, that didn't matter. And the reason it didn't matter was because countless other people, wildlife biologists, ethologists, and other scientists, had dedicated much of their lives to doing just that, studying, learning from the bears, like this one, the creativity, the collectivity of the bears. And because of them, I knew this was a black bear, not a grizzly bear, and that black bears rarely attack unless provoked. Because of them, I knew black bear mothers typically give birth in the winter. If this bear happened to have cubs, they would be older and less threatened. Because of them, I knew that black bears in early fall must gorge on food to prepare for hibernation. I noticed on the way up the canyon that this slope was covered with huckleberry bushes. So I lowered my gun. With an ambiguous grunt, the bear turned around and raced back up the steep hillside with breathtaking speed. I stood there for a long time, and then at last headed home. It was a moment that offered to once more quote Professor Descolas' wise words, a formidable stimulation to think anew. Thank you.
Yes, I'm delighted now to introduce our second commentator today, who is David Wengrow, Professor of Comparative Archaeology in the Institute of Archaeology at University College London. Professor Wengrow is no doubt well known to virtually all of us as the co-author with David Graeber of a remarkably ambitious and provocative rethinking of human cultural and political history which carries the modest title, The Dawn of Everything, A New History of Humanity. This book was an instant sensation. I remember I went down the first day of publication to pick up a copy at Moe's, and it was already sold out. I had to put my name on the list for the second shipment that they were expecting. And it seemed, you know, as soon as it appeared, it seemed everyone had a copy and was thinking about its extremely interesting arguments. The book challenges the Rousseauian narrative of the arc of human development as a movement from the egalitarianism of hunter-gatherer communities to the inequality and hierarchy associated with the emergence of agriculture and the concomitant rise of cities. Professor Wengro and David Graeber contend that this narrative overlooks evidence of much more egalitarian forms of urban life in areas ranging from Mesoamerica to Ukraine and Moldova, evidence that challenges the assumption that urbanized life is inevitably accompanied by inequality, political hierarchy, and the loss of freedom. The book was an immediate bestseller and has been translated into at least 30 different languages. If The Dawn of Everything is Professor Wengro's most famous book, it's hardly his only significant contribution. He's conducted archaeological excavations in Africa and the Middle East, and his research has resulted in numerous publications, including three other books: The Archaeology of Early Egypt, Social Transformations in Northeast Africa, circa 10,000 to 2650 BC, What Makes Civilization, The Ancient Near East and the Future of the West, and The Origins of Monsters, Imaging Cognition in the First Age of Mechanical Reproduction, from 2013. He's held visiting positions in Freiburg, Cologne, Auckland, and at New York University, and he's delivered numerous prestigious lectures at institutions around the world. In 2021, he and David Graeber were ranked number 10 on Art Review's Power 100 ranking of the most influential contemporary contributors to the arts. Very impressive. We're extremely pleased to have Professor Wengro in Berkeley for these events and look forward with great interest to engaging with his reflections on Philippe's Tanner lectures. Jane? Oh, okay, yeah, sorry.
Thanks, Jane. Thank you so much for the invitation and for your hospitality. I'm really grateful for this opportunity to continue a dialogue with the work of Professor Descola. I tried to calculate how far back that dialogue goes, which I reckon now is getting on for at least 12 years or so, to the time when Philippe and Anne-Christine Taylor mounted their exhibition at the Musée du Quai Branly. Oops, I seem to have done that. An exhibition called La Fabrique des Images, The Making of Images. That exhibition presented an installation of objects and images from diverse cultural traditions and periods of history, which illustrate the four major modes of identification, which also turn out to be ways of seeing, as John Berger might have had it, that we heard about in these Tanner lectures. Animism, totemism, analogism, and naturalism. As it happened, I visited Philippe and Anne-Christine on the final day of the exhibition, and they took me around very generously. And you may remember this, we stopped to inspect the visitor's book, where an enthusiastic member of the public had written a message along the lines of, wonderful exhibition, 1,000 new ways to see the world, to which Philippe reacted with mild irritation. No, you've completely missed the point. It's only four. I mean, it's funny, of course, but it also encapsulates the kind of intuitive tendencies that he actually addressed at the very start of his first Tanner lecture. In particular, the tendency to polarize our understanding of culture into competing extremes of hyper-relativism or species-wide universalism. by trying to find a middle ground between these extremes, comparative anthropology of the classical sort pursued in these lectures is perhaps a counterintuitive thing. But it's one that I've always been attracted to, speaking as an archaeologist who has collaborated with social anthropologists who share a common interest in preserving the comparative foundations of our two disciplines. What I've learned from these collaborations, I think, is that the reunification of archaeology and anthropology, after some generations now of mutual estrangement, is both powerful and necessary to overcome certain prejudices in the nature of our evidence, which are a direct result of 500 years of empire, colonialism, and genocide. The problem is well illustrated, I think, by previous anthropological attempts to dislodge the kind of stubborn evolutionary, social evolutionary, not biological evolutionary, social evolutionary assumptions which Philippe referred to in his first lecture, and I'll quote him directly, whereby all human groups are destined to go through the same stages and perhaps one day, with the help of colonization, become societies similar to those found in Europe, with the same kind of separation between economic, political, and ideological apparatuses. Earlier attempts to disrupt that teleological cast of mind include classic studies from the 1960s and 70s by Marshall Sahlins and Pierre Clastre. And although Clastre is not mentioned explicitly in these Tanner lectures, it's difficult for me not to detect a critique of his thinking, which goes back in Professor Descola's work, I think at least to an essay published in the 1980s on the characterization of Amerindian chiefs. What all those critiques shared was an exclusive reliance on comparative ethnography, combining sources in Amazonia, Australia, Africa, and elsewhere, with little recourse to the archaeological record, which in fairness probably wasn't much up to the task back then. As a result, Clastre's Society Against the State and Sahlins' original affluent society blended back all too easily into the older structures of thought. A universal age of freedom, freedom from the state, freedom from materialism, freedom from onerous labor regimes, followed inevitably by some sort of fall from grace. The strength of an archaeological perspective, which I assume is the reason for my presence here in Berkeley this week, is that today, does someone need to take a call? Got it. Is that today archaeology really can complement the kind of analysis provided by Professor Descola in some important ways, none of which, I should add, involve the use of analogy, strictly speaking. In other words, we're not, or at least I feel we should not, be seeking analogies among ethnographic data to fill gaps in the historical record. Rather, by extracting a clearly defined grid of relational schema from a dazzling wealth of ethnographic studies, Professor Descola offers an analytical framework for asking new questions of the deeper past as well. So what can archaeology offer in return? Perhaps it is simply the possibility of freeing these categories of analysis from the tyranny of the present, which really is a tyrannical present that consigns animist systems of knowledge, for example, to a marginal role on the world stage, which is, as Philippe was saying, also often a role of active resistance against global capitalism and against the predatory incursions of the nation state and of business. However, and if I understand you correctly, Professor Descola also argues that by characterizing such systems of thought, primarily as so many cases of societies against the state in Klaster's sense, we fail to understand their truly political nature. Or rather, we reduce it to a kind of negative reflection of our own dominant institutional forms, and so smuggle the state back in as a telos of history just by the back door. In effect, as Isaiah Lorado Vilna has put it, the state wins twice, first with the sword, then with the pen. These Tanna lectures have highlighted for us something of the enormous richness of indigenous intellectual and political life that is rendered illegible by such a move. A deeper historical perspective, I suggest, allows us to further challenge that form of circular argumentation, which keeps these alternate or alternative systems of thought safely contained in the realm of small-scale societies, and at the same time isolates our own values and systems of knowledge from the challenge they pose. In fact, much of what archaeologists have been doing for the last few decades, especially I feel in the Americas, is, or maybe should be, complementary to Professor Discola's project of unmasking and querying the many subtle ways in which the model of the Westphalian nation-state smuggles itself into places and periods of history where it really has no business residing. It's been clear for some time that the Americas before European conquest offer many cases of expansive civilizations, the unity of which is most consistently expressed not in traces of administrative or military power, the tools of Westphalian sovereignty, but rather in the use of images to activate links between local groups and superordinate networks. These links may be predatory or complementary, or more usually some complex mixture of both. But until the rise of the Aztec and Inca, they rarely coalesced into anything resembling the European notion of empire. I am thinking of such notable examples as Chavin de Huantar, Ohio Hopewell, Cahokia, about which I'm going to say a bit more tomorrow, and Olmec, Mexico. To the initial astonishment of European discoverers and commentators, it turned out that regional polities of this kind, often covering geographies as large and as diverse as those of much later empires, could in fact mobilize labor to produce monuments of precise dimensions and spatial orientation, stone carvings, ceremonial ball courts, or figurative earthworks, on a scale more typically associated with the literate polities of ancient Egypt, Mesopotamia, and China. Slotting cases like these into a framework of social evolution based on Eurasian principles of state formation has proved difficult because such frameworks assume from the outset that power resides in ownership of landed estates and other clearly demarcated resources and in the capacity to administer and defend them. Still worse, in national museums and at World Heritage sites and in scholarly publications, we are routinely presented with images of these ancient polities that are in complete conformity with Westphalian notions of sovereignty, just as they are completely at odds with indigenous conceptions of political space, like this one, for example. Chavin, Moche, Olmec, and so on appear as clearly demarcated territories with hard borders superimposed onto the maps of modern nation states. I suspect we would do a lot better to think of these ancient polities along the lines suggested by Professor Descola, which means finding ways to represent them in time and space that go beyond the two-dimensional logic of cartographic schemes or polygons framed by fixed borders, and more closely approximate his description, and I quote again, of complex and dynamic networks of relationships taking concentric forms with decreasing density from particular centers or foci, which are themselves always on the move and shifting. In that way, we might yet learn how to decipher them as expressions of political relations before, behind, and beyond the state, but nevertheless, governing relations among tens of thousands of human beings, as well as assembling patchwork ecologies into regional systems of formidable scale. Much of this, I think we can safely assume, took place under the sign of a cosmopolitics whose gestures towards and compacts with a host of other beings, non-human and meta-human, are still there, just about, for all to see, crisscrossing the landscapes of modern states in the form of geoglyphs, petroglyphs, rock paintings, and figural earthworks, which these same states now claim as part of their national patrimony, a case of broken contracts or you've been framed, as with these effigy mounds of the upper Mississippi. At times violent and terrifying, at times seductive or diplomatic, such monumental gestures and compacts are often fully visible only from above, a God's eye view, much like those tree plantations of the Sacha Runa, which now look upwards to a godless sky. But to conclude, I must also confess some doubts, which I expect us still be chewing on well into tomorrow's discussions. And these are really questions to myself as much as to Philippe. And there are basically two of them. With particular reference to Amazonia, I wonder, have we been too quick to celebrate the archaeological discovery of ancient urban civilizations, or maybe galactic polities in Stanley Tambaya's sense, below the canopy of the rainforest, without really acknowledging the challenge that this poses to our very definition of all those words, ancient, urban, civilization, polity? And following on from this, are we perhaps in danger even of slipping back into assumptions of a social evolutionary kind? The Brazilian anthropologist Luiz Costa reminded me recently of Claude Lévi-Strauss's comment, which comes in the overture to Mythologique, that historians should think of the ancient Americas as something akin to a Middle Ages which lacked a Rome. Now, I think you can understand this in various ways. For me, it raises the question, if Chavindahuantar and its successor polities were not some kind of Rome of the Andes, then what were they? And what kinds of power did they express? What did resistance to such forms of power look like? How did it flourish in those enormous free spaces, the kind of megazomias beyond the centers of power? And how did such processes, unfolding over a period of 2.5 millennia, shape the cosmopolitics of sub-Andean populations that would eventually confront and be confronted by European invaders, Europeans, of course, who were not yet moderns in the sense that Philippe, I think, means the term. And I'll say a bit more about that tomorrow as well. Pierre Clastre may have been completely wrong in reifying the state as a trans-historical principle of political organization. But given the deep and turbulent history of center-periphery dynamics, now revealed by the archaeology of the Americas. Was he perhaps asking the right sorts of questions after all? Questions about systems of domination and resistance, centralization and peripheralization. And more to the point, as the anthropologist Audra Simpson argues in her remarkable book, Mohawk Interruptus, could modes of identification and modes of political resistance be ultimately two sides of the same coin? Thank you very much.
Okay, the concluding part of today's session will be some brief responses, about 15 minutes, by Philippe to the two sets of comments. I just want to say in advance, we're not going to have time for discussion today, but this is just a compelling reason for all of you to come back tomorrow, where a seminar-style discussion amongst our four invitees will open up into a general discussion with the audience. So come back tomorrow with your questions, please. Philippe?
Well, let me thank first the two discussants for the wealth of analysis they've deployed in responding to my propositions. The anecdote that Thibodeau evoked of the encounter with the bear is a very interesting one, in the sense that it shows the encounters with deeply different forms of life can be successful only if one is at the same time knowledgeable about this deeply different form of life and what kind of behavior it will develop in that case, in the meeting of a human. And at the same time, being convinced of the radical alterity of the non-human that one encounters, and this you mentioned by reference to anthropocentrism, which I think is quite classical of naturalism. Anthropocentrism is an attempt, which is quite clear, for instance, in the narrative register of folk stories, for instance, which means that wild animals have to evidence some qualities that make them recognizable as a sort of humans, which is entirely different from animism in that respect. I was struck by that by discussing with an art historian who specializes in representations of animals in the 19th century, and she pointed out very clearly that painters, there's one in France who was quite famous, a woman called Rosa Bonheur, was painted both domestic animals and also wild animals. And the reaction that these paintings usually elicit is, they have a gaze like a human. And precisely, it's trying to make these animals look like humans in their gaze is something which an animist would never do. Animism is treating a radically different form of life as an alter ego, but not as a projection of oneself. And this is the great difference. And so this brings me to the remarks you made about the fact that the divide between humans and non-humans have been progressively dissolved by ethology in particular, so by the study of systems of signs among animals, by the fact that humans are not homo faber anymore, since many animal species are able to produce and transmit techniques that vary according also to local variations which are not ecological. This has been shown quite well. And so what does that mean? It means that in terms of the way we treat non-human animals, there has been a tendency in moral philosophy in particular to consider them as having some rights that are that should be proximate to those of humans. I'm thinking about the Great Ape Project, for instance, because they show cognitive and technical capacities or a possibility to experiment sensible experience that are closer to that of to those of humans, and so the idea would be that to open up the club of humans and grant to forms of life that share with humans some characteristics to grant them a status which is different from the one that is most common now. I think it doesn't allow us to jump out of naturalism in the sense that it's only an expansion of the individualist philosophy, whereby specific rights are granted to the human species because it has a specific nature, and this specific nature can be discerned in a blurred way among species of animals. And so the club of political subjects could be expanded. I think it's this which has received a great deal of attention and interest and militant action also, is less interesting than the other option that you mentioned of the Wanganui River and other types of milieu elsewhere in the world, which have received a legal personality in the sense that it's an intellectual revolution that is much broader and with far more radical consequences than the fact of granting personal rights to certain species of animals. Why is that so? Because the fact that a milieu is an owner of itself and that it has legal rights in that respect, which is based on the possessive individualism of moral philosophy, implies that the direction of appropriation, which has been one-sided for a long time, from individual or collective humans towards land or resources, reverts to the fact, which is for anthropologists is very common. I mean, in anthropological literature, there are scores of quotations where people say, we do not own the land owns us. And the idea that a milieu is the owner of the forms of life that are deployed in this milieu would imply a complete reversal of the attitude of humans towards, of certain humans, not all humans, of certain humans, especially since the development of the enclosures towards land. And I think this this movement, which is taking a certain amplitude in many parts of the world, is an interesting sign that naturalism, if not crumbling, is at least not as strong as it was before. As a matter of fact, as I was saying, I've been invited in June to participate to a session where people are trying to give legal personality to the Loire River in France, which is the at the same time the largest river, if I remember correctly, and the wildest also in the country. And there are several cases in Europe. One was not long ago, the Mar Menor in Andalusia, in southern Spain, which is a laguna that was given a legal personality. There are cases in Canada, cases in Colombia. They are not, until now, complete in the sense that there is no conflict of appropriation, in the sense that it's not stated that the Huanganui River or the Atrato River in Colombia owns itself, which would mean that it could sue humans who would appropriate it wrongly or in a destructive manner. But I think it may come, because the legal base is there for that. And so it all depends on the jurisprudence. So, and I think that even politically it's interesting, because it's not a right that is being granted, but a right that one has to fight for, as all the cases that we know where legal rights were given to a milieu, they proceeded from a struggle led by local people who wanted this milieu precisely to become a political subject, in a way. So thank you for mentioning this dimension. I'll turn to David's comments. You may remember that among the remarks in the Golden Book, there was one which I really enjoyed a lot, and it was obviously a little girl who wrote it, and it said, "When I'm older, I want to be an animist." And when I saw that, I said, "Well, the exhibition is made its point, no?" it's the just before coming here, I was co-writing an article that we are submitting to Science on with a colleagues archaeologist on a series of mounds or earthworks in the Amazon, in the Ecuadorian part of the Amazon, which is a huge setting, which has been an archaeologist colleague of mine worked on that some 10 years ago, but thanks to LIDAR now, we have an idea of the density of the mounds there. And so we were discussing whether it was appropriate to call it urban, precisely. Of course, the idea of calling it urban is a way to push, and you mentioned that quite clearly, against the primitivism of Amazonian, of the vision of Amazonian Indians, who were unable to extract themselves from hunting and gathering unable to construct or build larger settlements. But in fact, it's a reaction, and it's understandable as a reaction, but it doesn't give us any idea of what it was, nor do we have any idea what these polities like the Chavin-Dewantar were. And so it's true, the question you pose at the end, that Cloud was, I absolutely share your conclusion that I think Klaus was wrong, but at the same time that he pointed to an important problem without being completely aware of it. He was wrong because you cannot, I mean, he was he had a transcendental conception of the society, you know, society against the state. So you have two entities, and society, as I try to show in these lectures, do not exist in the sense, in the Durkheimian sense, in the Amazon. It's not something which is transcendental, which is an hypostasis that is more than the sum of its components, that would act as a sort of transcendental subject in order to eliminate the risk of domination by a single person. So in that respect, he was extremely Durkheimian, and it's but at the same time, his endeavor was to try to conceive politics in a different way than the one we are used to. And so he had to use the state, but at the same time, he posed a right question. What is it that drives people if it is not a sort of common rejection of the state, of a state that would be, which is a bizarre system that society as an institution to get something which does not exist but is a threat. But at the same time, he tried to understand what politics were in a non-state society. And in that respect, I think that very few people have done that since also in many respects, you know? And so, I think he posed the right questions, or he gave a wrong answer to a right question which he did not formulate in a way, but which you did formulate yourself. And it is, how do we consider sociologically these formations which appear to be state-like and which have entertained relationships with obviously non-state societies, or collectives for many years. Anne-Christine Taylor and I have surmised that the what were formerly known as the Jivaro, the Einstichem, were in fact expanding. This is a technical question, but I think it's important. From the coast to the southern Sierra of Ecuador and the forest. So in fact, it was a huge linguistic group, and it was obviously not a state-like formation, but it used many different ecosystems and was based on what you mentioned, that is local groups that tend to be articulated by a superordinate something. What was this something? We have no idea. And it's very difficult to imagine it now. So I think, yes, archaeology and anthropology are again in cahoot and trying in this comparative endeavor that we share, because I think that comparative endeavors are very important, and it is I've been a staunch advocate for comparatism. It's the only way to escape what I call from time to time ethnographism. That is it's not navel gazing, but it's the navel gazing of your own subjectivity in a specific fieldwork. Of course, it leads to nothing. It leads only to a satisfaction of being someone with a keen observer and is in a warm relationship with the people who have given him or her access to the world. But comparatism goes much beyond that, of course. And comparatism is necessary to try to understand the complexity of the world, and precisely not to infer from how the way we see things the ways that other people see things. So comparison is the best antidote to ethnocentrism in that respect. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you, everyone. Thanks for coming today, and come back tomorrow. Look forward to seeing you then.